Dr. Ronald D. Siegel is the Assistant Clinical Professor of Psychology at Harvard Medical School. He joins us to discuss both mental and social benefits of mindfulness practices.
Thank you, Art. Thank you very much for having me.
What is mindfulness?
Mindfulness is actually a way of relating to our moment-to-moment experience in life. And it's a way of relating to whatever happens with awareness of this present experience and then working to accept whatever arises. And most of us, when we hear that, we think, well, that's easy. I can be aware of what's happening and accepting of it. But actually what happens when we start to do mindfulness practices, which are designed to cultivate mindfulness, is we notice that actually much of the time, at least half of the time, the mind is wandering. It's not actually present to what's happening. It's thinking about the future, it's thinking about the past, and it's kind of angling for how am I going to get pleasurable experiences in the future and how am I going to avoid unpleasant experiences. And the irony is, by not being present, by being so caught in the future and the past, we actually wind up much less happy and, in fact, can get ourselves caught in all sorts of psychological problems.
Is there a difference between mindfulness and concentration practices?
That's an excellent question. There are actually thousands of different kinds of meditation practices, and some are designed to cultivate concentration per se, which is the ability to focus on an object and keep attention there, and some are designed to cultivate mindfulness, which, as I'll explain, is a little bit different. Concentration practices, where we learn to focus the mind on one object and stay there, are excellent for calming, for being able to savor experience, to actually taste our food, to actually be able to smell the roses. Mindfulness practices take these to a next step so that once we develop the ability to concentrate the mind, we use it to see how the mind creates suffering for itself, how certain patterns of thinking, certain patterns of reacting lock us into patterns of stress, lock us into patterns of reactivity that make us unhappy. So, for example, with mindfulness practice, we might get to observe that the constant scheming, trying to come up with ways to feel better and avoid negative feelings might keep us stuck in a problem. A good example of this is noticing what happens when we experience insomnia. When we're having trouble sleeping, it's much worse usually on a Sunday night than on a Friday night. And the reason for that is on Sunday night, we start to worry, uh-oh, I'm never going to get to sleep. I'll be exhausted tomorrow at work. That's going to be so unpleasant. And we start to see how, for example, struggling to get to sleep gets in the way of getting to sleep. And there are countless other examples of watching the mind through mindfulness practice and seeing how we inadvertently get ourselves into trouble that causes a great deal of discomfort and psychological distress.
Dr. Siegel, can you give us an example of mindfulness and its impact on everyday life experiences?
Sure. There are many examples of the ways that mindfulness impacts everyday experiences. Part of it is savoring, just as I mentioned, being able to do what we think of as single tasking, to actually be able to enjoy the moments of our lives because we show up for them. But the other one is it can help us with a lot of problems. It can help us with difficulties like anxiety, like depression, like substance problems. It can even help us in interpersonal relationships. And one of the ways it does this is it fortifies our ability to be not just with pleasant experiences, but also to be with the unpleasant experiences. So that means, for example, if I get nervous with public speaking or I get nervous getting on airplanes, but I develop the ability to be comfortable feeling that nervousness, staying with that anxiety, bringing my mind back into the current moment, then I don't develop a disorder around it. I just get a little nervous and it passes and I can engage fully in life. Similarly, for example, if I might have difficulty in an interaction with my wife, if she says something that upsets me, if I can learn to be able to be present to and open to whatever those upsetting feelings are at the moment, then I might not be so reactive. So I might not immediately go to defend myself or say something that's going to hurt her and start a whole cycle that could turn into an argument. So there are countless examples of ways in which learning to bring attention to the present and learning to be able to be with both the pleasant and the unpleasant experiences that arise actually free us from the kinds of patterns that cause us a lot of distress.
How can parents, teachers, other community members use these practices to improve their interactions?
Any of us who works with other people could probably benefit from some mindfulness practice. At the very first level, what happens when we start taking up these practices is our minds tend to show up more for the interaction. So I'm a clinical psychologist. I work with people in psychotherapy. And I sometimes joke, you know, therapy goes better if we both arrive in the room. But similarly, parenting goes better if we both arrive in the room. We all know, any of us who have raised kids know, that when we're distracted, kids know it immediately. They pick up on it right away, and they simply don't behave the same way as when we're really present with them. So simply developing the capacity to be present becomes quite helpful. And that's the same if we're teaching, if we're doing any kind of thing that deals with other people. The other thing that happens in these practices is we become more and more able to both enjoy pleasant experiences and stay with and not get too reactive to unpleasant experiences. And whether this is me as a psychotherapist needing to be able to sit with somebody who's very sad or very angry or very frightened and not get too frightened myself of the experience, but being able to really connect with them in this, or for that matter, a parent being able to be with their child who is very sad or the child who's very angry or very frightened and not be overwhelmed by the fact that the child's distressed, but be able to feel the child's feeling and yet stay with them and provide a sense of safety becomes very powerful. And the same is true for a teacher, for a nurse, for a police officer, for a physician, really anybody who's working with other people, particularly working with other people who are experiencing distress.
Dr. Siegel, are there resources available to our viewers to learn more about mindfulness practices?
With growing interest in mindfulness practice in the mental health field and in medicine, there are more and more resources available for looking into this. At a certain point, I was asked to write a book about how to develop these practices in one's own life and how to use these practices to deal with everyday problems, things like anxiety, depression, struggles in parenting, even the difficulties that come with aging. So one resource is this one. This is a book that I happen to be the author of. This is called The Mindfulness Solution, Everyday Practices for Everyday Problems. And linked to the book is a website. It's mindfulness-solution.com. And the website is free. And on that website, listeners can find lots of different meditation practices. There's perhaps 20 different practices there suited for different purposes and different life situations, but certainly breath meditation, eating meditation, walking meditation, some interpersonal meditations. And those are free for anybody who'd like to download them, try them on their own, try them on their iPod and the like. The instructions for when you might use one instead of the other are contained in the book.
We would like to thank Dr. Siegel for his informative and useful promotion of mindfulness practices. For more information on mindfulness practices and techniques, please visit www.mindfulness-solution.com.